So I'm very pleased to be back out here and share some of the research insights on the global state of the ICT developments around us. Earlier today, we had this wonderful group of young adults, children, led by Reggiani. And it was a wonderful demonstration of how music is transforming the lives of these young people. If you think for a second, what kind of a role do we play as ICT professionals? I would argue that we play a very similar role. Of course, we use different tools. Information technology is our set of tools. But what we are doing is really transforming the lives of people around us. Look back at the last 20, 30, 40 years and think how life has transformed, not just for us individually, but for governments, companies, and societies. Think about all the entrepreneurs, there are many out here in the audience, who have created new companies, created wealth, and realized their potential, all because of information technology. And this is an enormous gift. It's a gift because we are part of the process of realizing the potential. Yet, at the same time, it also poses significant challenges. Because as was mentioned by Santiago earlier, all is not great with the state of ICT in the world around us. My goal in this brief presentation is to give you some hard numbers, some insights based on 16 years of data collection. Data collection conducted by the World Economic Forum in collaboration with major universities, INSEAD in France, and my university today, Cornell in the USA. Now, in this report, the Global Information Technology Report, if you haven't seen it, please feel free to search for it in a search engine and download the report for free. There is a certain model underlying that. And this model is something which was created back in 2000 when the World Economic Forum put together a small group of experts, and I was one of the experts in that group, to come up with a model about how do we conceptualize the impact of technology on development of nations. Now, this model has a pretty simple structure, and it's deliberately kept very simple. It looks at the environment in which technology is applied. It looks at the readiness. How ready is society or a country to use technology as a function of affordability, skills, and other factors? It looks at the actual usage of technology by the key actors, individuals, businesses, and governments. And it also looks at the impact, the economic impact and the social impact. There is a whole process by which we collect data, we compute data, we end up with some kind of overall index, and each year we produce a ranking. This ranking, of course, gets a lot of visible media attention, and certainly does show examples of nations that are leading the world in using technology effectively for competitiveness and development. If you look at this year's ranking, Singapore is at position number one. And then you have a collection of countries from around the world. Of course, Scandinavian countries dominate, but you also have the USA at position number 5. We have almost 140 countries covered in this year's edition. And you can go through and look at the lists and look at the links. You have details of variables. You can identify positive, negatives. And you can perform analysis of various kinds. I will not talk much more about the precise rankings themselves or describe to you the various mathematical procedures. What I'll focus instead is, after having done this for 15, 16 years now at a stretch, what are some of the insights, what are some of the lessons that we are learning out here? And I would emphasize 3 messages. Of course, there are many more that I could choose to describe, but I focused on 3 which I think are particularly relevant to us today. So the first one really is, it's very clear the digital revolution is here to stay. We see this time and again. There are so many examples of nations and companies doing extremely well. But what is extremely important is we have to create effective innovation ecosystems. Otherwise, change does not happen effectively. Another message which we see is, if you look at economies that are doing better than others, and you understand how the performance varies over time, we notice that 7 economies stand out above the rest. And those 7, if you actually go and ask the question, what are they doing especially well? What you see is that they are excelling in getting their businesses to use technology effectively in all dimensions. So the business readiness, the business usage, the business impact is exceptionally high in these 7 economies. And the last message is a more sobering message. I think Santiago touched upon this briefly. The whole notion that today, despite all the progress, the digital divide is here, but not just here. What we are seeing is it is in fact growing, and growing especially so in a different dimension, which is the impact of ICT. So I'll talk briefly about these 3 points. And if I have some time at the end, I will add a couple of thoughts about Brazil and how Brazil can perhaps leverage full potential in the ICT world. So let's look at the first picture and the first message. Now imagine for a second New York in the year 2009. Imagine further you are the mayor of New York. What do you see happening around you? You see the financial sector in collapse. You see media, which was one of the strengths of New York City, being challenged by the internet, major media houses on the verge of bankruptcy. And you see California running away with the technology prize. If you are a bright, visionary, courageous leader like Mayor Bloomberg, what do you do? So what Mayor Bloomberg did, he said, we have to change the economy of New York City. We have to create a digital innovation ecosystem in the city. Of course, he himself is a technology entrepreneur, so it comes natural to him. But he wanted to make that an integral part of the city. So how do you do it? So he held a global competition. He said, I want to invite the world's leading technology universities into the city, and I'll support them, I'll make life comfortable for them to establish a strong base out here. A global grand challenge. Many universities around the world competed, and I'm very proud that in December 2011, Cornell University was awarded the prize. So what was the prize out here? The prize was that the city was going to give us half of Roosevelt Island. Half of the island, which is just south of the bridge. Some of you might have been and seen the cable car that goes across the cable, across the bridge. And in 2017, next year, you will see this campus emerge of Cornell Tech. I wonder if I should use the microphone. Should I switch? Okay, so in 2017, what is going to happen is this amazing infrastructure is going to come alive in New York City. But what is really happening out here? What is happening out here is a unique partnership between a major university, the city government, the local private sector, and civil society to change the ecosystem of New York City. Now, what is happening also out here is that the universities have to change. If the universities don't change, you'll not really get the kind of change you want to see happen. Because the change has to come in multiple ways. So for the first time, corporations are being invited in to establish a physical base on the island next to the city, adjacent to the faculty and staff. For the first time, the university has reached out to a foreign partner, in this case, Technion. Technion is a leading innovative hub of entrepreneurship in Israel, and said, can we in fact invite the best from around the world to join hands with us and partner with us? What is also happening out here is professors at Cornell Tech are being required for the first time as part of the contract to teach in the local middle schools in New York City. There are links being built between a major technology university, the major research professor in the university, and the local middle schools. Why? Because the perception is very clear. We have to influence young minds in the middle schools before they, in fact, make the big choices. Now, in all of this, you have an interesting set of lessons. None of this would have happened without the leadership of Mayor Bloomberg. Leadership is critical. Universities are at the heart of the innovation ecosystem. Of course, the best examples of it include the Silicon Valley and Stanford and Berkeley at the heart of it. But time and again, what you see is universities that attract talent, conduct high-quality research, build partnerships with private sector, are at the heart of it. But universities also have to change, and they have to form an effective partnership with the government, in this case, the New York City government, the private sector, and civil society to create this kind of innovation ecosystem. And the global perspective is also important. Technion, Israel, is part of the project. Now, you can take these lessons from one example, but I would pose that such similar lessons apply to almost any similar transformation initiative you might want to put in place that attempts to change the economy of a region, economy of a state. And I think Cornell Tech provides a very good lesson in that direction. Let's go to the second key message, which is really around the seven economies that I said stand out. And the reason they stand out is because of the business sophistication that their corporate sector exhibits.
So just focus on the red lines out there. So there are different regions of the world, and this is all based on data from the Global Information Technology Report. The red line shows the capacity for innovation, and the capacity of innovation is going up around the world. So that's good news. The good news is, doesn't matter which economic sector you look at, the capacity for innovation is going up. Also, what you see at the same time is there's a huge gap between countries. So here you see a set of lines. The top seven are in the top line, and the top seven countries are listed in the column on the right. You will see the other advanced economies is the second blue line below the top seven, and you will see a whole bunch of other economies pretty much bundled together close by. Now, this is very interesting because what it shows you is there is a gap. And in fact, our data and research shows that this gap is not decreasing. In fact, it is increasing. Why? Because of a number of factors. But one of the important factors is that technology, when done successfully, has a very important multiplier effect. The actual impact is many more times higher than what you might actually invest if you get the entire system working right. Now, if you look at those seven countries in some more detail, what you start seeing is business lies at the heart of the success. You could take any one of those countries, but let's take Singapore as an example. I used to spend many months in Singapore for many years. I'm sure many of you have visited Singapore. Most likely we have some delegates from Singapore also in the audience. If you think about what Singapore's sole focus is, the sole focus of Singapore is focus on talent on one side, but make life simple for business. In every single possible way, the sole obsession of the government is to make life simple for business. And of course, that permeates through every single strategic element of the country. And that is also a core element of the national ICT strategy of Singapore. Now, if you look at what are some of the core drivers driving this business change, business innovation, I would argue that the whole rise of Internet of Things, the rise of artificial intelligence, the rise of cloud computing has magnified what I would say is the soft part of products. If you think about the traditional view of products, we thought of products mainly as physical entities, a bottle of water, the physical bottle of water, a chair on which you're sitting, the clothes that we are wearing. But today what is increasingly happening is along with the physical product, the information part of the product is increasing. And in fact, as devices are getting connected, as Internet of Things is emerging, all these devices are leaving a huge trail of data. Today, for example, you have value chains, supply chains, in which wine bottles are tracked. You can keep track of the temperature at every single moment as the wine is transported from one destination to another. And you have all kinds of examples in which the soft part is becoming not just more prevalent, but also more valuable. And this trend is continuing. What you also see is there is a tendency to try to change the culture of the company. I don't know how many of you saw this recent statement in August 2016 by Jeffrey Immelt, the CEO of GE. He said, every single person I want to hire has to learn, has to know how to code. Think about it. GE is a 100-year-old company. I used to work at GE for some time. And now what Jeffrey Immelt is trying to do is change the whole fundamental DNA of the company. Why is that? Because even for GE, GE sells these enormous engines. And previously, these engines were huge physical products. But now, along with engines, the information content, the information is collecting from all the engines worldwide and building a database to benchmark and feed back information back to the customers. That is proving to be of incredible value. The whole portfolio of business has to get transformed. GE is becoming a digital company. And that's what you see in the advertisements, in the logo, in the push of the company tremendously. Look at this graph. It's a very interesting graph. But before I explain the graph, think about 20 years ago. 20 years ago, think about how your technology at home compared to the technology in the office. And for most of us, I would argue technology in the office was better than technology at home. So we went to the office to do the more complex technology things. Think about today. How does the technology at home compare to technology in the office? And I would argue that today most of us sitting in our home have access to more versatility, more different kinds of technology options than what we have in office. What is the message out here? Companies are in fact falling behind customers and employees. And this you see it very nicely in these graphs. This is based on data. The red line is the individual usage line. And you see that with exception of low economy countries on the extreme right, the individual usage has really gone up dramatically. While the business and the government usage, the other lines, are moving at a much slower pace or are flat in most cases. So what is this telling us? It's telling us that the gap between what customers, what employees, what citizens can do and expect, and what we are ready to provide as organizations is increasing, not decreasing. And that is a challenge for corporations. So what are some lessons out here on the corporate innovation side? Leadership once again becomes important. Like Jeffrey Immelt, you have to push this digital innovation right from the top. There is a set of technology trends that is favoring this kind of a drive towards digital innovation becoming more widespread, more embedded across all companies. And this trend is going to keep on increasing because Internet of Things, because of artificial intelligence, because of cloud-based computing, because of cheaper computing, and everything else that we know of. What we also see is that if your culture does not support it, the change will not happen inside companies. And what I think is especially challenging is the gap of expectations between what the customer expects, what your employee expects, and what the company is providing in technology often is growing. So a lot of potential, yet challenges. So let's come to the third message out here, which is a much more sobering message. Because really what we have always thought, and this was something which, if you go back 20 years, when the first commercialization or the first societal spread of internet taking place, people hoped and thought that now with increased access, you would reduce the gaps between the haves and the haves not. But as Santiago already mentioned, this gap is not showing any signs of shrinking. So let's just take a very basic element in terms of internet penetration. And if you look at the trends of internet penetration by different income groups of countries, you see that there's a substantial gap in the internet penetration of these countries, and this is based on 2015 data. Now, if you look at the pickup, the rate of diffusion of technology, I hope you can read those numbers, but let me give you the high-level picture out here. On the left-hand side, what you see is you see the time it took for mobile penetration to reach 80% of the population in those income groups. You see that the time is more or less the same across the different income groups. So the penetration of mobile phones was in fact quite quick in low-income, middle-income, and high-income economies. And that is consistent with what our observations are. If you look at the right-hand side, it shows the same amount of time, but for 60% of the population to have internet. And you start seeing the gaps appearing, where you have some of the lower-income economies not even having reached the 60% threshold in their own countries. Now you just build a separate set of data out here that has broadband, and if you include the quality of broadband, the situation becomes even worse, because this is just basic internet access. It doesn't talk about the quality of broadband access on the internet. And if you look at the low-income economies, and you look at the rate of growth of internet penetration in those economies, even if you took the last 3 years and you say that, well, let's assume this carries on for the next decade or more, it'll take us at least 12 years for these low-income economies to reach 75% penetration of internet. And this is assuming that the cycle of technology adoption does not slow down, which often happens, as you know, in many cases. So what we see really is we are facing a very important challenge. And I think this is the sobering reality of the global state of ICT. While on one hand, you see these amazing opportunities, you hear of these amazing stories, the reality is that the gap between the haves and the have-nots is not shrinking. If anything, it is increasing. Earlier, we talked about digital divide based on access, mainly linked to access to technology, internet, and so on. But the digital divide in terms of impact is even higher. If you don't have education, if you don't have the right kind of organizational support in a company, if you don't have that kind of context in which to use technology effectively, the benefits of technology do not really flow to citizens and to organizations. So what are some last sort of lessons out here? I think we all have to be humble, because while we all are very bullish on technology, the reality is that the digital revolution is still incomplete. And in fact, if we do not have good changes that make significant improvements in some of the key underlying policies for education, for infrastructure, and so on, we will not be able to close that gap anytime soon. And if anything, this increased gap is going to lead to increased inequality. So there was another session that I took part in a conference where the question was posed to me, is ICT decreasing or increasing inequality in the world? And today, my position is that ICT is increasing inequality in the world. Contrary to what we might have thought 15 years ago when we thought ICT might decrease inequality. But all the data shows that the inequality actually is increasing, and there is no signs to show that this inequality increase is going to decrease in the future unless something dramatic is done in the context in various organizations. So let me close with maybe a couple of thoughts about Brazil. Those are the three messages that I thought I wanted to convey to you based on 15 years of data analysis. Brazil is a great country. I think Jim and Santiago and others already talked about it. I think Brazil, we also realize, is going through a tremendous crisis, probably one of the biggest crises coming out of it now, but has gone through a tremendous crisis in recent history. Focusing on the ICT component, let me just offer you two suggestions. I will not talk about infrastructure, I will not talk about ease of doing business, I will not talk about education. All of these things we all know need improvement. Let me just focus on two things. The first one is vision and strategy. Please, and this is a request to you all collectively in Brazil, make sure your politicians, make sure your government realize the seriousness of how technology has to be integrated into the national vision at the national level, into the local vision at the city level, into governor's level at state levels. I have had the pleasure of working with some ministers in Brazil, some local government officials in Brazil over the last several years. And it has been a very slow and sometimes difficult transition to move the mindset from natural resources, because traditionally 15 years ago it was only industrial policy in Brazil, to a more soft digital resource mindset. And I think this is unfortunately a challenge in a country that is blessed with so much rich natural resources, where a lot of the economy is driven by commodity exports. So I think the first request, the first suggestion is the mindsets of leadership in the country has to really embed and incorporate digital and ICT as a tool for improvement, for change of the country. The second suggestion is around brand. You ask someone outside Brazil, what is Brazil's brand? And the brand is often around sand, around samba, around soccer. It's a very happy country, nothing wrong with that. It's a great life, a very happy country and happy people, but it's not really around innovation, not really around technology. And I can tell you that that brand positioning is very important because Brazil has got great companies. You have Embraer, which is a leading technology company. You have other examples of IT companies in the country. And somehow the branding effect hasn't fully worked. Let me close with one real story from my own experience. As some of you might guess, I come from India. And when I went to America to study as a graduate student in 1985, in the incoming sort of opening reception of foreign students, an American friend, a very good friend of mine today, he asked me the question, did you go to school in a bullock cart? Okay, it wasn't a question to be mean to me, just a very friendly question on his side, because that was the image of India that he had back in 85. Fast forward 20 years, I was going through the immigration in Switzerland. I gave my passport to the police control immigration officer. He looks at the passport, he looks at me. The first question to me he asks is, are you a software programmer? And for me, that encapsulates the change in brand. India is still a very poor country, got terrible infrastructure, lots of problems, but the brand of the country has changed. And I think, of course, NASSCOM, many others have done a fantastic job in building that, but the brand of the country, brand of Brazil, needs to be changed. So thank you so much once again for the opportunity to share these thoughts with you. And I wish you all a successful and a wonderful conference. Thank you very much.